Go ahead and get started here. Welcome everyone to the Kansas City Tableau User Group virtual meetup. We're going to let Jay start sharing his screen while I kind of go everything. First up, what we're going to do, we've got an awesome lineup for today. We are going to be doing, we're going to kick everything off with trivia, Tableau trivia. 20 questions. We're going to use Kahoot. So grab your, open a browser on your desktop or grab your cell phone, go to kahoot.it and enter that game pin right there. And we will go ahead and get started in just a second. Got, we will be playing for prizes. We've got some awesome Tableau gift store gift cards that we'll be giving out to the top five finishers. And excellent. We've got some good, we got some amazing nicknames coming up right now, which is awesome. So what we're going to do is we're going to give prizes out to the top five finishers. And we've got a $50 gift card for the number one overall, and then $25 gift cards for places two through five. So go ahead and, like I said, go ahead and get your mobile device or grab a open tab on your browser and start adding up kahoot.it. Enter that game pin and we're going to get started here in just a second. After trivia, we've got Lucas is going to be doing a really cool problem solving presentation where he was presented with a problem at work, a real life problem, and then kind of walk us through the thought process and how they kind of work together and use some of Tableau's new features to solve that problem. And then after that, we've got a really great presentation coming up from Erin, going to be doing some speed tipping. I can't wait to see that. Everybody loves speed tips. Tableau tips and tricks are one of our most requested tug features. So she has set the bar high for herself. I hope she's able to meet it, because that would be amazing. So we're gonna do that. And then lastly, we're looking towards looking back on 2020, looking forward to 2021. I'm gonna share with you everything that the Tableau community has to offer you that you can use Tableau community to help set your intentions and goals and resolutions for 2021. So, all right, got 49 people registered so far. Which is awesome. So I think you can still join at any time. I think the game pin stays on the screen the whole time. So don't worry about that. I will drop that in the chat just to be sure that we get that. So, but I think we can go ahead and get started, Jay. Nope, Jay, you're on mute.
There we go. Sorry. All right, we got some trivia questions today. Kahoot, just enter the answer as soon as you see it, and the fastest time gets the most points.
Who was the first Kansas City Tug leader?
Good job, guys. Yeah, to recap, kind of say the question as it goes up. You get a few like buffer seconds before the answers pop up. And then you have 10 seconds to answer it. And then the faster you answer it, the more points you get. So 10 seconds, 1,000 points. So if you answer it within 1 second, you're gonna get 900 points. So starting off with some KC Tug trivia, I'll do another one. So there we go. Excited Storks in the lead. Next question, where was the first KC Tug meeting held? Parkville Coffee Shop, Park University, Stone Canyon, or Grinders? Ooh, only five, yeah. Close, it was in Parkville and it was at Stone Canyon Pizza there, right across from the analytics office where Ryan worked when he started the group. Right. Next. What year was the first Casey Tug meeting held? 12, 13, 14, or 15? A few of you guys got it.
Excellent.
7 years ago.
7 years. That's awesome.
Lovely Swan still in the lead. All right, next question. How many Tug meetups were held this year for Kansas City, including virtual and in person?
You remember back in February, I wanted to say we wanted to have one every month.
Yeah, one every month. We got over half. Forgot
That's
seven.
That's right.
We got seven. Lovely Swan, killing it.
Four in a row. Erin, is it?
All right, next question. What year was Tableau founded? On to the Tableau questions. Good job. It's been a while.
Nicely done.
A few high jumpers, okay. Next question. Who is one of the original founders of Tableau? Got some familiar names on here. So if you guys know your Tableau trivia. Good job, yeah.
Christian. Excellent. Tableau.
Nice.
If you haven't ever seen a Christian Chabot Tableau conference keynote, I highly recommend you go watch the 2010 keynote. He's an amazing speaker, so highly recommend.
Awesome. All right, next question. Where is Tableau headquartered? Should be an easy one, hopefully.
Should see everybody answering that question.
Yes, Seattle. Couple in Vegas, yeah.
You certainly go there a lot.
Yeah, there's a lot of conferences there. It's their second headquarters. All right. How many visits are on the show me pane? Get into the product now. How many visits are there in the show me pane? Some of these are gonna get pretty deep.
That's right. You gotta know your Tableau product knowledge.
24, that's right. It's 25, it's 3x8.
We had some a little bit of changes in the scoreboard.
Yeah. How many quick table calculations are on a measure bill? All the ones that are listed. How many are there? There's 11.
Ah,
some that are great out for the time, but yeah, there are 11 there.
That's right. So this was a good one because we know that several of them are always dithered out, but we wanted to know the actual full amount. So depending on how you've set up your sheet, you could get all of them. So we wanted to get a little bit tricky with them.
There we go. What year did Tableau Public launch? Yes, 2010. Yeah.
Yep.
10 years ago.
Yeah, they just had their 10-year anniversary on Tableau. There's a really cool blog post out on tableaupublic.com.
10 years. There's over a million visits now, right? I think that happened like a couple years ago.
Yep.
Yeah. All right, and what version were LOD calculations introduced? 8, 9, 10, or 10-2? Back before there was...
We probably could have reworded this as to when did table calculations almost become obsolete?
All right. Yeah, 9.0. It's a while ago. So where was Tableau Conference supposed to be held this year? Las Vegas, New Orleans, LA, or Austin? Yes, Las Vegas.
Very good.
Be there next year. What version were Hyper Extracts introduced? Hyper Extracts. Is it 9 or in the 10s? It's 10.5. Yep. 10.5.
Coming up here to the end.
Oh, lovely Swan Falls.
Oh. Uh-oh.
All right. I'm going to have some more of these questions. What version were floating objects introduced?
So floating objects on a dashboard were introduced in this version. So fun story about this one. 8.0. So this has a Kansas City connection. So this is the, I can't remember the year, but this is the version that got Ryan Sleeper into the Iron Viz competition. So, which he then ultimately won. So the Iron Viz feeder competition was take a tiled dashboard and use the new floating objects to reproduce your dashboard. And so by doing that, he was able to get into the Iron Viz competition.
Nice. And then win it. Yep. All right, 15. What customer in the sample superstore data set has the highest 4-year sales? What customer?
Test your knowledge here, guys. Yeah.
John Miller.
Yeah, that's right. So it still amazes me every time I open that superstore that I'm in there. It's just, it's so random.
It is. It is. Love it. Okay. This one's a multi-select, all right? What are the 3 product categories in the sample superstore data set? So multi-select. You gotta hit
select. On this one. Yeah. Select any 3. And these are the, there we go. People, yeah. I love it. People know their superstore data set. Yeah. That is awesome.
You're excited. Start the commanding lead now. All right, what version were dynamic parameters introduced? Yes, 2020.1 came out this year. All right, a couple questions left. What year did Tableau Prep debut?
Just had a recent TUG meetup regarding Tableau Prep.
Yep, 2018. In 2 years, almost 3 years. All right, a couple more questions left. What version were vector maps introduced? Nice. Yeah, good job, guys. It's a tricky one.
Yeah.
All right, last All question. Right.
Last one.
I think Excited Stork has it, but we have prizes through, like, what, 5 places?
5, right? Yeah. Yes. So anybody on the screen, everybody on the screen will win the next, on the next screen.
So was it 50 for the winner and 25 for each, yep, to the store. And they got some really good swag. It's really high quality stuff. My favorite travel backpack is Tableau. All right, what is the 2020.4 feature release? So it came out today. What came out today? Timely question. Map layering, that's right. Map layering came out today, which adds a whole new dimension to it. See.
All right, here we go. Elated Condor in third place, Hero Lizard. And dun da da da. Excited Stork. Excellent. All right. Is there a way that we can see the... There we go. All right. So if you are in the top five, please send me an email at sean.miller@cerner.com. I'll put that in the chat. Send me an email and I will get you that. I will get you your game card. Awesome. That was fun. We're going to see if we can't continue doing that. Hopefully you all enjoyed that. We can continue doing more of those. So it's a good, great icebreaker starts and you get to win stuff, right? So, we're going to go ahead and keep it moving. We're going to kick it over to Lucas to show us some of the cool stuff that he's doing over at Ericsson.
All right. Can you guys hear me?
Yep, we can hear you okay? And see your screen.
Sounds good. Just a quick introduction, by the way, great activity there on the trivia. Even though I saw a good chunk of those answers beforehand, I think I would have still lost it. Very hard questions in there. So good job for those that won. So I'm with Erickson, co-leading the user group here with Sean, Jay, and Erin, senior BI developer. Been messing with Tableau for about 7 years now, if I'm not losing track of time. So for this action today here, the idea was we wanted to start not a series necessarily, but go over day-to-day examples, some customer requests or things that you've worked on to try to find solutions for, maybe not fully out of the box solutions. And that's what I plan on showing today with something that came up at our work through one of our colleagues. So is Tableau up here for everybody? Sean or Jay, one of you guys confirm?
Yes.
Can you see Tableau?
Yeah.
Awesome. So the use case we had, I mocked up some data here for Superstore. We'll use the furniture, office supplies, and technology as well. I'm sorry this presentation didn't come before the trivia, because then that would be an easy answer for you guys. but the request here was the user wanted to filter on a specific category, either furniture, office supplies, or technology, and then be able to create a chart or display a chart with a specific measure as it relates to that category. Now, I know the Superstore data set doesn't look exactly like this because you don't have chunks of missing pieces like this. I just mocked this up for this demo. But the idea is that for furniture, for example, we have data for discount and for profit, but profit ratio is not there. It's not meaningful for furniture. For office supplies, on the other hand, we have discount and profit missing, but we do have profit ratio and sales. And for technology, we don't have discount, neither profit, and we also don't have profit ratio. We only have sales. So the idea from the user was, if I select technology, I want the dropdown that only gives me the option to pick sales and then display that on the chart. If I pick office supplies, I should only see profit ratio and sales. And furniture, I should see discount, profit, and sales. Don't show me options that are fully null. That was the request. So we started tinkering around and thinking on how to solve this. And we thought about using dynamic parameters or cascading parameters, if you will. And we ran into some challenges like Tableau released the new dynamic parameters, but those things were relative to when a workbook opens. We haven't really found a way to mess with it as you're playing with the visualization after it renders. So one of the options we came up with, of course, you could tackle this with extensions. That's just one of the many ways. And I'm sure there's others as well besides what I'll cover today. But what we ended up doing was we created a simple mapping in Excel where we had the category pointing to the applicable measures. So pretty much what I covered on that previous sheet, but just in a concise way. So then moving into Tableau, let me go here to this one. I'll clean some of this stuff up. So this is out of the box Tableau. Nothing here I can take credit for on this viz. You all should have access to this. But the idea, like I said, was we select the category and then these charts here change depending on the measures that are applicable to that category. So first thing we had to do, we created two parameters. I have already done some of that work here beforehand to save time on the presentation. I'm going to move this out of the screen just for now. But yeah, the first one we have is a category parameter. It's just a string list. So we picked a string and typed in all of the three different categories. This solution is fixed. So if you were to get a new category, we might be able to leverage dynamic parameters for that at a later point. But yeah, so we entered the categories on this first parameter. And then on the second one, we just did a measure selector. So those four valid options that we had, we entered it here as a string parameter. So in order to apply those to the view, I mean, right now, sorry, I'm jumping all over the place here. If I go to furniture to office supplies, we don't have any type of behavior. They're not linked together. So we don't have a cascade feature quite yet. But let's say we did. I just want to first modify these sheets to be able to show the applicable values here that get selected on this dropdown. So I'm going to jump onto one of those sheets and I created a calculated field called dynamic measure. Very simple. It just looks at whatever measure the parameter has selected. And then if it's profit, it's going to display, of course, the profit calculation. If it's ratio, it's going to change the ratio, sales for sales and discount for discount. So just a one-to-one relationship here. And I can change, of course, the sales to that dynamic measure. So now if you toggle back and forth, you'll see those values change, right? I'm going to just remove the title here on the axes just so that that dynamic measure text goes away and we're still clean. And then on the view, I'm just going to change the title and insert my measure selector. So there's an indication of what's been selected. So far that's the behavior we want to, that we want to occur once the cascading options are in place. So how do we move on to the cascading side? Again, just covering one of the possible solutions. For us, we created a new sheet with that mapping that I showed in Excel. So you have category, oops, let me go to text here, category and measure. So we see what's applicable on both sides. I'm going to expose these here again, just so that we can track along. And the first step that we did was created a filter to say, if the category on my data set equals the category on the parameter, I want to filter that specific, those specific records. So I have a category filter going in here. And if I set it to text, you'll see that what I have selected sets to true. And if I toggle between different things, that true is gonna jump around. So as my filter, I just want to show true and that's it. I'm gonna hide category because I don't need that here. Drag measure into text as well. So I can hide this guy as well. Do a little bit of formatting and remove the shading, the row banding from this stuff. And that's what I want up to this point. So I'm gonna save this as my option list, if you will. And now I can drag that sheet onto my view. So the attempt here is to try to recreate, I'm gonna put this here just for now, is to try to recreate the behavior that this parameter here contains, but that is only relative to the previous selection of office supplies. So if I toggle this to furniture, for example, you'll see three different options now. If you go to technology, you only see one. In office supplies, you see two. Now, with this being Tableau, you want things to look nice, right? There's different ways that you could style this and fit on your screen. My goal was to make it look exactly like any other out-of-the-box component in Tableau, like this region option right here. So to do that, just messed with a little bit of formatting. I'm going to drag a text object in here, and I'm going to call this my measure selector, if you will. Just for consistency. Oh, it's a little darker than the others, but you guys get the idea. Remove some padding here from the bottom. And now I'm going to add another text element. This one, I don't actually need anything in it. I just want a very fine border associated to it. I'm gonna mess with the height and do 27 or so. and mess with the padding as well a little bit so that it aligns just like everything else on the page. So now I'm trying to recreate that behavior where, you know, I'm trying to build that cascade parameter, if you will. I have that empty box. If I just position this guy close to it right here, you can hopefully see where I'm trying to go with this exercise. Now, I want to be able to select something from my list, and it needs to confirm my selection and display it up here inside the box. So to do that, I'm going to create another sheet and just call it my selected option. And this one's going to be very, very simple. All I'm doing is I want to read what measure has been selected on that parameter. So I'm going to create another field and call it my selected measure and point to the parameter that we created. I'll drag that to text, style it again a little bit, go onto my view, and I can drag that element onto the screen as well as a floating object. If I make it really small, I can just try to fit it in here. It's not going to look perfect per se, but with a little bit of patience, you should be able to trick the user to pretend that that always belonged there. So let me mess with a little bit with the background so we have a better shading, I guess. And now we can test this. So if I select a different measure, you'll see that is already displaying there on the screen for me. And we're getting closer to the behavior we want. However, the idea is not to use this control. I want to be able to pick from this drop-down list and then update the value that's in here. So to do that, we could use a dashboard action, use a parameter action to use a sheet, to then change a parameter. So to do that, we'll go to dashboard, click on actions, I'll remove these. We won't need them for the demo. We'll do change the parameter. I'm gonna say change my measure. In my originating sheet will be my option list. I want it to be on click. I want it to change the measure parameter by looking at the measure field and hit OK and OK again. So now if I select this, this option here changes and then it reflects inside my little table down below. So I now can get rid of this dropdown because at this point it does me no good. So from a cascading perspective, we're really almost there. I mean, you select a category, you see the options are different. I can select sales and this is going to update. If I go into office supplies, you'll see the options are different. I can go to profit ratio and select that. Now that's when you know, if you have some free time on your hands, that's where you try to go in and add more bells and whistles to this solution. So I was looking at how Tableau has this behavior here on its filter. And number one, it does give you a little bit of highlighting once you hover over one of the options. So that's one. When you, of course, click the drop-down arrow, you get the list. If you click the drop-down arrow again, it collapses it. And then if you click on one of the selections, it enforces that and hides your list. Right now, my list is pretty dumb. It just shows there and it's sticking. It's not doing anything. And of course, I don't want that. So here's a little step-by-step, my to-do list, if you will, based on what I just covered, things that I would like to accomplish. Let me put this here to the side to make my parameter, my cascading parameter, something that looks like it came out of the box. So the first thing I'm going to try to tackle is highlight once I select one of these. And that's where we can introduce set actions to this solution. To do so, we're going to create a set. I'm going to take my measure field and create the set. I'm just going to call this my measure set values. And I want every single one of my options. Don't want to do anything with it yet. And I'm just going to set it to color for now. So right now, everything is inside the set and it's giving me a color blue. I'm going to change that for a specific shade so that it looks similar to what Tableau offers by default. And you can see that the names here are now highlighted. Now, that's not really the behavior I want. I want the entire record, the row, the background to light up. So to do that, we can just convert this chart into a bar chart. I'm just going to use a one here on columns. Oh, it's still set to text. Sorry, change it to a bar. And now we can change the axes from 0 to 1 so that it fills the entire screen. And get out of that, remove the header because I don't need it. And then I can push my label to the left. So right now it just seems like everything is selected, which is, it is the case, but that's not the behavior we want. But if I jump onto my solution again, you'll see we have the bars on both of them. So let's mess with the dashboard action here. And before I go there, let me just expose the colors so it's easier for me to mess with them. So on the dashboard action, I'm going to create a new one. This time, change set values. It's going to originate again from my option list. Highlighter. And I wanted to mess up with my measure set values. I'm going to say remove all the values from set once you clear it and hit OK. So now once I don't have anything selected, everything is out. I can just change this color to white. And once I have that, if this works correctly, I should get, need to adjust my action now. I want it to be on hover, and I want everything to be removed once I remove the hover. So if I come in here, you'll see that I'm getting a fairly close behavior to what Tableau shows on its solution. We could mess a little bit with the padding on both sides to not cover the entire row, but I'll keep it at this like this for now. So the first to-do item, which is highlight when hovering options, we have tackled this one. So I'll mark it in blue. So the next one is I need to add an option for it to, I need a dropdown for this. One possible way is to use the button functionality in Tableau. There are some problems with that because there's not a lot of configuration you can do on a button besides show and hide. So I'm not going to cover that. I'm just going a longer route, which is adding an icon to the view. So in this case, I'm going to go here to my sheet again, and I'll just create a dummy field to activate the sheet, change this to shape, and I have a custom loaded shape that all I did, not very efficiently, and I'll blow this up here to be able to show a little bit better, was I took a screenshot of Tableau's actual filter, cropped it up, and then brought it into Tableau again. So I can mess with the sizing in here a little bit. I know it looks terrible on this view, but once you drag it over to your visualization and you hide the title, just modify the layout here. Let's do 17. No borders, that went all the way here. We're gonna push it just right inside that container that we created. So to the naked eye, to the untrained eye, you might get away. I mean, there's a little, you know, it's missing a little divider, but we can adjust that later. But the idea is that when you go here onto full screen, that you can trick the user to think that all of this solution has always been there. So I have a button in here now that just has this letter A. I want now to be able to click this button and then it show this list and then hide it once I unclick it. To do so, on the icon list, we have this letter A, which pretty much it's a constant. Every single record of data has the letter A on this sheet. So I'm going to do the same thing on my option list. Sorry, I actually need to make this a calculated field before I use it. So I added the same A onto my option list. Every single record has that A, so I'm not filtering on anything necessarily. I'm just assigning that value to the record. So I can hide that. I don't need to display it. And on my icon sheet, I'm going to do the same and hide it here. So what this allows me to do now is to create an action. This time, just a regular filter action that goes from my icon sheet, the drop-down icon, and messes with my option list. On select, what I wanted to do is look for that field called A. And when you select it, filter for all records that have A, which are all of them. And when you unselect, exclude all the records that contain that letter A, which is all of them. So if I set that in here and I click this button, it should disappear. And when I click it back, it's back on. So by doing that, we've accomplished steps 2 and 3 here, displaying and hiding the sheet. Now, what I still don't have with this solution that I created is once I select something, my list is still here. It's still stuck. It's not doing anything. I mean, it's obtaining the results that I'm after, but it's stuck. It's not hiding like it would be with a regular Tableau built-in functionality. So to address this last piece, I created another parameter called sheet swap. There's a lot of blog posts and techniques on how to do this, some very simple functionality on the tool, which just contains a 1 or 0 or a show or hide, just almost like a true or false flag. What we want to do is whenever this parameter has the number 1, we want this sheet to display. If it's set to 0, we want it to hide. For us to do that, we need to create a new calculated field that just looks at what that value is. It's pointing to the parameter, show hide filter. Make it a dimension here. And when I drag it onto the view, I can say, I only want to display this once the value is a 1. So we can test that really quick. It's a 1, things are showing. If you change it to a 0, it's gone. So that's the behavior that we want out of this. So if I go onto the view again and expose that parameter, I set it to show, it's hidden right behind here. You drag it out and I go to 0, that disappeared. If I go to 1, that disappeared. But selecting still gives me no impact. So just like we did the parameter action to populate this container up here with my selection, I'm going to use that same trick to manipulate the result of this parameter here. So I'm going to go back to the sheet. Sorry, I know I'm covering a lot of ground, especially if you're just starting with the tool, but these sessions will be recorded on YouTube. So there's always the opportunity to go back and watch it again or ask me any questions, or I'll send the workbook if this is something you might be interested in. So how do we tackle this problem now? I'm going to create a new entry in here. Just going to say it's a 1. Set this to be, a discrete value. Dimension, move this over to the front, and I'm going to hide it as well. Sorry, that should have been a 0, but I'll undo my idea here. And if I go to my actions again, we'll create a new one that goes from the option list, and it changes my sheet swap with that value of 1 with no aggregation. So this is going to be my hide sheet action. So what I'm doing here is when you select an option, it's going to read what value is inside that constant of 1 and going to update that parameter called sheet swap with the value of 1. And because I set the filter to show at 1, that should have been a 0. So let me change this here to a 0, sorry. There we go. So if I click on this now, of course, live demos, what could go wrong, right? I want 1 to show. I have a 0 in here. Let me undo my action and do it again. My option list, select sheet swap, field 0, that's a 9. All right, there we go. So when I selected it, it changed that parameter to a zero and it disappeared because we have a hard-coded filter in here that only allows it to show when it's a one. So getting really close to it, now I have my option four also coded for. However, because this is a hard-coded filter, zero and one, my original functionality of clicking this dropdown is lost its purpose until this gets changed back to a one. So if you guessed, I need to do one more action, but this time going from this dropdown and modifying this sheet as well. So a little bit confusing, but those were the workarounds to get to where I needed. So I'm gonna create a constant of one, change this to discrete, make it a dimension. Oh, sorry, wrong order of operations. There we go. Put this in front of the view. I'm gonna hide that header and remove my border so it looks clean again. And we're going to create another action, this time to display options. This one is going to go from the icon sheet, modify the sheet swap with a number one and no aggregation. There we go. So now if I select this, this becomes a one and my sheet shows. If I select something like sales, this becomes a zero and it disappears. If I select this again, it's gonna go to one. I get my dropdown. And if I decide not to click on anything, I can just select my collapse menu again. Last thing, just formatting the values. You can see they are a little bit slanted compared to the selected option at the very top. To address that, we can just push things out a little bit. I'm gonna put this here on label. On label. You can give it a few bumps. And I lost my measure. I'm not sure what I'm doing wrong here at this point. Is it because I have it at a one? There we go. I'm just gonna remove this, give it a few bumps. And now it should look very similar. If I go on full screen, let me get rid of this. Very similar to what the default behavior is of Tableau, where you get the highlighting, you can close it, you can expand, you can select something and it will go away. And it is also, it cascades the options that are applicable to your previous selection. So if there's something that doesn't belong there, it's just not going to display. With the combination of three parameter actions, one set action, one filter action, a few calculated fields, and that's about it. So I know I went through a lot, had some bugs in the middle of the demo, but hopefully some of this made sense and I can answer any questions if there are any, or if I maybe just lost everybody in the, as I went through this. But
no, that was really great, Lucas. Thank you for walking through that.
So the point of this, Sean, just wanted to wrap this before we go into questions, if there are any, is this is not necessarily intended to be a production solution. It's more one of those things that if someone asks you to do something, just don't immediately go to the mindset that no, that can't be done in Tableau. Sure, there's gonna be a series of workarounds and level of effort to get there, but it can be accomplished. Now, if you have three or four of these in sequence, you can see how cumbersome it would be to build, but it's just a way to change the mindset of, sure, there might be a way for us to get there if you, you know, try a few different things and spend the time to pick some of the features that the tool offers. So that's it.
Yeah, no, that's great. There's lots of really great comments in the chat. One of the questions that came up is curious how long it took you to kind of not just develop, but kind of take us through your thought process and working through all of these different things, you know, to obviously to a newer user, a lot of these features and functionalities might not even be, you know, at the top of mind. So can you just speak to two things? One, how long did it take you to kind of come up with this process and come up with a solution? And two, can you talk a little bit about, you know, the ROI, like, you know, was, you know, thinking about, talking about the discussion between, is it worth putting all this effort into versus working within the tool?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So for a level of effort, the thing is, and what I wanted to point out as well with this is, a lot of these ideas you get from watching what other people do. There's a lot of great tips out in the community. They may not be doing this example specifically, but someone used the set action to do the highlighting, and someone used the parameter action to do something else. And that's just by exploring what's out there in the community. That's when you start piecing these things together and it clicks. It's like, oh, I could go this route. It definitely took me a couple of days to figure all of the mechanics out, because, you know, at one point for me, it went beyond just what the customer was asking to hacking my way around and say, well, let me see if I can take this one step further to make it look like it came from Tableau. I mean, I could have stopped and just given that sheet with options, that sheet right here, and that really accomplished the goal. But, you know, and that was fairly simple, but it was more like, how do I incorporate the highlight? How do I make this stuff disappear? Once you see it in action, it's really not that complicated at this point, but it's just, you know, it's a trial and error. I started going with the buttons feature in Tableau to display or hide that dropdown, and it was working great. But then I couldn't make my container disappear when I selected a specific mark. I couldn't activate the button with that click. So that's when I was like, all right, let me regroup, try to go a different route. And then I thought about the sheet and putting the dropdown icon, and there it goes. So, yeah. And as far as the ROI, I would say it depends on the ask. I know it's a terrible answer, but, you know, is this an executive level dashboard? What's the visibility associated to it? Is this something that's going to go to your C level, or you know, it just depends. In this specific case, I have no problem in pushing this as a production version, but let's say we had a cascade of 5, 6, 7, I would probably push for a different solution, because it's not worth it. In my opinion, it wouldn't be worth the time.
Yeah, for sure. Yep, I agree. And those are great points. And that's just, I'd say, you know, to the rest of the community and the rest of the people watching, that's definitely something, those are definitely choices that you as the developer have to kind of think about. And those are the choices that you have to make in making a analytic product. So I think this was really great. And this is, I'm sure that there are pieces of this that people are going to be like, oh yeah, I'm definitely going to use that for my next dashboard in some point or fashion. So I had another question come in. Just talking about, let's see, customizable dropdown. So yeah, then that's kind of what this solution kind of helped to do. And like Lucas said at the end there, just kind of trying to think through, you know, what is the level of effort? You need one dropdown menu. Okay, I can do this. But as Lucas mentioned, if you need 5, 6, or 7, then we probably need to regroup and kind of rethink things. So,
and if you're comfortable working with extensions, this could have been accomplished at a much easier way if you have that aptitude with,
right,
you know, JavaScript, or you have someone on your team that does, you know, with a few lines of code, you could address the same functionality. And there might be other ways to do this as well. Mm-hmm. I by no means want to say that, you know, this is the only way. There's a lot of super bright people out there in the community that come up with some crazy, crazy stuff.
Yeah, cool. All right. Well, we're gonna keep this rolling. Thank you, Lucas. That was amazing.
My pleasure.
Definitely check out the chat. There's some good stuff there too. So, all right, we're gonna keep it rolling here. Erin, you ready to show off some speed tips?
Yeah, I just want to underscore, like, That was fantastic, Lucas. I learned so much. And I think one other thing I would just throw out there is that as you're working through those kind of solutions, maybe at the end, the ROI actually isn't the drop-down list. Maybe the ROI is that you figured out how to use set actions and parameter actions for the first time. And you know, sometimes the prompt that comes in where you really, you take that rabbit hole to the very end, sometimes the neat thing that comes out of that is then in another situation where the ROI might be actually much higher, you have that knowledge kind of filed away in the back of your mind. So I just, bravo, Lucas, that was so fun to watch. So, all right.
Thank you.
So I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen. Let's see. Go ahead and do this. And give me just a second because Google has decided to sign me out. So let me do this really fast and see if Google will let me back in. One of the fun parts about using Google Slides as opposed to PowerPoint. we'll see if everything wants to play along here. We'll go into, perfect. Give this a second to all load. I think we should be all good to go. And Sean or Lucas, will give me a quick sanity check that you can see the PowerPoint.
Yep, you're good.
Awesome. Okay. Speed tipping. we'll see how fast we can do this because that's kind of the point. So this will hopefully be kind of fun. This is a session that was a lot of fun to build this week. I had a really fun time kind of talking with the team here and thinking through what, you know, tips and tricks are always exciting. And so we'll talk about lots of different things here. The goal is 60 tips in 30 minutes. So we'll see. I'm not starting my timer until we're into the actual workbook. So hopefully this will be a fun way to kind of wrap up the year as we're closing down 2020. For those of you who have been joining us through all these virtual meetups, it's been really wonderful to see the participation. I think I speak for everyone on the steering committee when I say like we've been really excited to see you guys tune in and participate. Even though we're virtual, obviously we cannot wait to be back with you in person in 2021. So for those of you I haven't had the pleasure of meeting yet, my name's Erin Waldron, Kansas City, born and bred, came home, and I have a small analytics firm here, Data Dozen, and get to do a lot of fun Tableau training and consulting with folks around town. So that's who I am. Let's dive into this. So like I said, the goal is 60 tips in 30 minutes. If you know me, I love to stay organized. So we're gonna break these into 15 tips in 4 categories. We've got organized data, tidy workbooks, beautiful visualizations, and flexible dashboards. So we'll kind of move through these 4 categories just to give you a little bit of a roadmap of where we're going. You'll notice the tips kind of cluster around a couple categories. So we've got data source, data pane, calculated fields sitting underneath that organized data. We've also got our menu bar, workspace, exporting functionalities for your workbook. Look for some building shortcuts along with some labels and tooltips, which sometimes get overlooked and they're kind of fun to think through a little bit. And then we've got flexible dashboard sizes. So dashboards that kind of contract and breathe a little bit given the dimensions that they're viewed on. So we'll talk about the size, containers, and the layout tab. And just to give you like a little bit of background before we dive in, because I want to make sure you know what the data source you're actually looking at before we're flying through this lightning round. So a little preface, this is going to be GDP by country. So we've got 217 countries from 1970 to 2018. So 49 years times 217 countries. That'll give us our number of records at 10,663, if my memory serves me. That's not mental math, that's memorization. So, and this is coming from the World Bank. Then we've merged that with some life satisfaction data. So we have some of the countries, not all of them, but enough to definitely be interesting. We've got a much shorter time span here, so 2005 to 2018. And then this is data is coming from the Gallup Global Happiness Center. And this the inspiration for these two together actually came from a Makeover Monday that I saw, which Sean will talk about in a little bit. So the data kind of looks like this. You've got, if you're looking, for example, at the United States, again, one row per year, per country, and you're gonna have moments where your life satisfaction data don't show up because we don't have it yet. You'll notice some countries go back to 2005. The US, for example, doesn't have the life satisfaction data showing up until 2006. So this is kind of what the data is gonna look like behind the scenes. I love that so many of these are sevens, just because anytime we talk about survey data, sometimes we say if we're doing like 1 through 10 or 0 through 10, you can't, 1 through 10, but you can't answer 7 because we tend to gravitate towards that. So apparently as a nation, we are also doing that. So like Sean put in the chat, this is being recorded. So that's fantastic. I also, in preparing for this, had to build a cheat sheet. So if you are following along, sit back, relax, breathe for the both of us. I have made a full like PDF cheat sheet or pocket guide that is on the website that you can check out. We've got the full Tableau workbook you'll see me working in. So you can download that and explore it, deconstruct what we've done. And then obviously this is being recorded, which I'll put on the website as well. So if you are interested in any of those resources, you can just go to my website, datadozen.com/speedtipping, Tableau speed tipping, and we've got all of that here. And then when pull that down, we've got the full pocket guide here as well. So hopefully that'll be kind of fun. I'm gonna close this out. Okay, are we ready? Let's grab a timer here on the cell phone and we'll see how we do. So brace yourself, everybody get ready, do your stretches. We'll see how we do. All right, 30 minutes is underway. So let's talk about organized data to start. I'm gonna go ahead and open up my data source here. Let's just go to a new sheet, toggle over to the data source tab. So A, okay, bonus tip, because I had this hooked up earlier. If it doesn't know, if it's a packaged workbook and it doesn't know where your underlying data is, you can always point it back at the data source itself. This is the CSV of the data. So there's two things I want to point out here. One, usually when you first connect to the data source, you're going to have a live connection, right? Because you're just going to have established that. And often when we're using live connections, sometimes it's a tiny Excel spreadsheet. I work with a lot of folks who are doing archival data in research labs, and maybe they've put it together by hand. And the data source itself is actually quite small. But sometimes we're connecting to really big databases. And while we're building, we actually would love to have a local extract, sometimes of a smaller portion of the data. So if you're building, if you're drafting, even if in the end you anticipate having a live connection, sometimes toggling to this extract can help speed up what it feels like to draft, because you're not actually executing a query every time you drag and drop a pill. Some folks also don't know that you can actually filter the data before it comes into your workbook. So we all take filters onto our worksheets all the time, but you can also add data source filters by just clicking that little add button. For example, here, if we knew that we only wanted to bring in the, you know, region of North America or something, you could click here, say okay, and then when you say okay here, it'll add a filter to the data source itself. That can be a really nice way, again, to slim down that data while you're actually developing your workbook. All right, so that's your data source tab. Let's talk about the data pane. Data pane, this is where it all lives, right? So a couple things here. You'll notice if you're brand new to Tableau, Tableau has taken its best guess and picked a data type for you. These little icons are clickable. So as you look at this, if this actually isn't a year or this is a number or something like that, you can click right here on that icon and change it out. Very helpful, especially for geographic areas if you need to say, hey, this is a county or this is a state or province. We also have the number of records, or as of 2020.3, you'll see it called count, which has to do with the change with the relationships instead of joins being set up behind the scenes. But either way, the big picture here is that you should know how many records you have, how many rows actually should be part of this data set. So one of my favorite things to do right off the bat is to take the number of rows here. This should make sense for again, 49 years by 217 countries. I also encourage folks, you can make visualizations out of this stuff. So you could break this down and say, all right, we have 49 for each of this. Oh yes, we do. Let's go ahead. Can I move this bar? Yeah, move this down here maybe. Can I go ahead and take this and then break it out by year as well? And I can. And actually, if I take this onto color and I just go ahead and show the entire view, I can see that I only have one color. Every single country for every single year has one record. Bonus tip, you can always just go ahead and uncheck show header to hide and clean that stuff up. So one of the other really neat things about being able to build something very quickly like this is that you know from the start that all of that data you expected to get, make your hypothesis, go and check it, that you expected to get actually is here. Then once you have it all here, it's time to organize it. So you can always toggle to sort instead of by the data source table, which is how the data pills are initially grouped, toggle it to groups, or from groups to folders. And then you can, for example, click multiple pills, right click, and you can create a folder or add to existing folders. Personally, I like to take most of the variables that I'm not going to use constantly and put them into folders, and then just keep out the variables that are kind of the workhorses of the visualization. Also, if you're ever looking for a calculation and you have a ton of them, like let's say GDP, you could go use this search box up here, and that helps you kind of slice and dice through all the data you're looking at pretty quickly. All of the variables do have default properties, which I think is something we underutilize. A great example is every time you use any of these GDPs, you're gonna want them formatted as either a percent or a dollar sign, you know, as currency. So when you, instead of pulling that out and doing it once on each sheet, go ahead and set the default property here with your number format. You can also do your aggregation. You can do sort on categories. You can also add a little comment, a little bonus tip. We do like, hello world. These comments, then when you hover over them, will actually show the comment you added. So if you're looking to incorporate a little bit of metadata into a data source that you're working with, that can be a good way to do it as well. All right, so default properties. Replace references. If you ever swap out your entire data source and someone doesn't find a buddy, let's say region got called regions, plural, when you changed out your data set and the column got renamed, you can always right click, go to the drop down menu, and then go to replace references, and you can point that old variable at the column that it should have today. Last thing, this with the data pane, if you lose your data pane, which happened to me, and I remember vividly one of my first Tableau experiences, I had done all this work on the data pane and it vanished. You can bring it back up. So if you ever lose your data pane, just take a look here at the bottom, and that's where it's hiding. That also can be helpful if you're trying to just hide it to give yourself some more real estate while you're building. Let's talk calculated fields. I personally love to give a preface, a little prefix to all of my calculation names. So developers will say, name your variable something that makes sense. I agree with that. Also in Tableau, I've been doing this for years, and it's really helped me be able to find everything that I created and quickly recognize, like, hey, if there's a problem here, it's probably because I introduced a problem. So that is something I like to do. If you're new to Tableau and you've never made a calculated field before, you get your pop-up box, all of your syntax or functions, they're hiding under this tiny little arrow here. You can click your drop-down menu, see the functions that go with different types of actions you're trying to do. These will look like functions in Excel or functions in R or Python, whatever you might be used to working with. This apply button. The apply button is amazing. It allows you, without closing your little text box here, to actually execute the new logic that you've written. Especially helpful if you're trying to fix something that still won't work. You can go ahead and just hit apply and see how it's rendering in your visualization and see if your calculation has started to make some progress. You can also always add a double backslash here and add comments to your calculations. I love to do this. If I'm leaving comments, for example, for a colleague or a client who might open this after me, but also for myself, if I might not look at this workbook for 3 months, come back to update it. What worked, maybe what didn't work. Sometimes my calculations will have a bunch of commented out code that's just, this didn't work, this didn't work, this didn't work, and I know why. This didn't work, I don't know why. So use the comments. And the last thing I will say in our organized data segment, tip 15 here, The calculation is valid. If you're new to Tableau, or maybe if you're not and just need a reminder, the calculation is valid means that Tableau can execute the logic that you just put in the text box. It does not mean that what you have written produces something that is accurate or intended. So Tableau can't read your mind. It's very literal. If you build a calculation, even if it says the calculation is valid, go build a visualization that verifies for you that your calculation is actually accurate. Two different things, valid and accurate, not the same thing. Okay, that takes us through organized data. How are we doing on time? Whoop, okay, we gotta speed it up. We're at 22 minutes. Let's keep going. On to tidy workbooks. All right, tidy workbooks, keeping your workbook tidy as you draft. First off, if you are new to Tableau, you might not know that down here in the corner, you can actually toggle how your sheets are displaying. So you can see all of them at the same time. You can show a film strip that'll actually give you a little preview of what's behind each of them, or you can do your tabs. And you'll also notice that you can, all right, let's keep moving this little guy. Got our Zoom bar up, we'll move that up here. You can also go ahead and change what your sheets are colored. So if we wanna change this sheet, we can change the color here. Sometimes this will help keep me organized, or things that are broken, I'll put in red. Another tip, you can actually hide all your sheets. So you'll notice if I go to this dashboard, there's a lot of sheets happening underneath here. If I right click on the sheet one, you can actually see unhide all sheets. They'll proliferate out. And then you can do the reverse where you hide all of the sheets underneath the dashboard once it's finished. One thing I really love to do is I love to go ahead and keep the some sort of naming convention with your sheets. If everything's going in dashboard one here, I'll do 1.1, 1.2, 1.3. So they all clustered together in lists. I'll also sometimes put what the visualization chart type is, like dots, 100% bar. So that as you get into something like here, where you've got life satisfaction, both as text and as a sparkline, they're easy to tell apart. And then when you're all done, you can go ahead and hide all of the sheets again, keep it nice and tidy. You can always duplicate a sheet. This is really helpful. Let's say you love this, but you want to keep drafting, see what else is out there. You can always right click and select duplicate. Takes all of your work with you, which can be really nice, especially if you've done a lot of formatting work or something like that. But another thing to keep in mind is you can also duplicate your workbooks. Now, duplicating a workbook is going to just create a new, or duplicate a dashboard. It'll create a new dashboard. Here's an important distinction between the duplicate button and the copy button. If you do a copy button and then paste it, it's actually going to create not just a new dashboard, which the duplicate function will create a new dashboard, but point it at all of the same original underlying worksheets. But if you copy and paste the entire thing, what you're going to run into is you've actually created all of the new underlying worksheets a second time. So if what you're trying to get is every single worksheet on this dashboard a second time, you're going to want to copy paste. If what you're trying to do is use all the same underlying worksheets, but maybe play with your layout a little bit or try something new, that's when you're going to want to duplicate. Okay. That takes us through our menu bar. Let's talk about our workspace. So if I create a new worksheet and I'm looking at my workspace here, I'm gonna pull that bar on down. When I'm looking at this layout, this is actually all flexible. So you can actually move the pages shelf. You can move any of these components around. And you know, there's different places that make a lot more sense, arguably, for some of them, but they're all movable. So set your workspace up the way you want it. You can always, if you get a little too crazy, reset the cards right back down here. So this little drop-down menu next to your little screen, you can click it. And if you're like, hey, I wanna get back to the baseline Tableau gave me, reset cards. You can also just always uncheck something. So I use pages very infrequently. Sometimes I'll just come in if I need extra room, uncheck that pages, and that card will disappear. One that I actually add quite a bit that I think is underutilized is the caption. If I pull up the caption here, let's go to maybe a sheet where we already have something on. If I go to the caption and I pull this up, it'll go ahead and try to give me a description of what's happening. And sometimes that's helpful. Sometimes that's what I want. Sometimes I'm just after the text box. So if I have my text box here, one of the neat things, I can put the time the data was updated. Right? Hit that, you can see we started this when I reconnected to the CSV at the very beginning of our time. This is when the data was updated. And I can also just have my notes. built in. So why isn't this working? I will leave notes to myself or think through, here are some notes that I want to have baked right into this visualization, and then I can get rid of those another time. So the captions are great. Show in the filter. Sometimes we take a pill, put it on filters, click the drop-down menu, then we show it. You can also cheat. You can go right to the data pane and just click show filter. It'll add it to your filters card, but it'll also populate that little pop-up box that we can send on to our end audience. And one thing I love is this little tiny, all right, let's move that over here. This little tiny sort of cheat sheet or summary stats that is hanging out in the bottom left-hand corner. I think it's one of the smartest things to do. If you look at your visualization, you have a sense, hey, how many marks should I have? How many countries should I have? How many, what's the total that makes sense here? Check this bottom area right here, because this is gonna be a really great way to have a quick summary sort of sanity check, if you will, as you're building. Okay, let's see what else. Last thing, on the marks cards, if you get lots of pills going, quick tip for some folks who are new, sometimes the order of those pills will actually change how Tableau executes a query. So if you're looking at something and you're like, why does my tree map have the colors broken down differently than the level of detail, try swapping the order on the marks card. Last thing I love to do, let's talk about exporting. If we bring out our full count here again, or just a subset, you can click on any of this and you can say view the data. You can then toggle, if you'd like, to the full data. And the reason that I always like to show people this is that when you are packaging up a Tableau TWB versus a packaged workbook, a TWBX, this is how someone could easily come in and get all of the data. You can also export all of the data right here. This can be really helpful if you're looking to export a CSV, or maybe you're just looking, hey, this specific mark, I just need to export the data right here. It's a really helpful thing, but an important distinction to make as you come in and you're deciding what you want to save this as a packaged workbook, all that data gets put together with the Tableau file versus a TWB that's going to point to another data source. So maybe it's pointing to a database, someone's got to go in, give their credentials, authenticate with that database, then the workbook will populate. Let's see. And oh, here's a new thing that I learned just the other day, like a couple months ago. Export as version. I was up to date until today when 20.4 came out, 2020.4. So if you ever need to export for a colleague who's on a different version, you can always go to this export as version under the file menu, get the version that you need. And the last thing I love to do, let's say you've got a dashboard that you're like, hey, this is in pretty good shape. Go up to the dashboard. You can always export an image. These images were really, I'll say mediocre for someone with a photography background, atrocious. When Tableau very first got started and exporting, they're so much better now. So when you go into dashboard, you can export the image of the dashboard. Same with the worksheet, export the image here. You can see it's grayed out because we're on a dashboard. But one of the things that's really great about that is you can throw that in the email or in communication or in Slack as a little teaser. If someone may not have time to log into Tableau server in that moment or go check your workbook, but you want to give them some context of here's the dashboard we're talking about, that can be a great little trick. Okay, that's 30 plus maybe some bonus ones. Ooh, we're short by a minute and a half, guys. Let's keep going. All right, let's talk about visualizations. Let's go ahead and create one. I'm gonna make a bump chart because even after all these years working in Tableau, the bump chart is still one of my favorite charts. So hotkeys can be really fun. If you hold down option, so usually if you bring out year, for example, it's gonna go ahead and pick which of the years you want. It's gonna default here to the discrete year. But if I hold down option on a Mac or maybe Alt on a PC, it will go ahead and bring up this list for me at the beginning, and I can go ahead and click year of year. So saves you a step, also can be a real great time saver when you're looking at something where you want to do a count distinct on an item that may have a ton of individual items in the variable. That can be a helpful way to shortcut right to your aggregation menu. So we'll do our year. Let's go ahead and grab our current US. No, let's do constant 2010, so we control for inflation. Here's our GDP. There's the financial crisis. And let's go ahead and break that out by country, add all members. Bonus tip there, if you are connected directly to a server and you get that pop-up menu of, are you sure you want to add all members, and you don't know how many members are actually there, that might be a time to hesitate. If you're connected to something local like a CSV or Excel file, you're probably fine and you're not going to bring anything, you know, to its knees on the server side. Okay, so let's see, we've got our GDP, but we're looking at, it's easy to see right now our countries that are really in the lead, but the bottom like 200 and some countries all kind of look like pickup sticks. So when we care more about the rank of something as opposed to the actual difference or discrepancy between two or three numbers, we just actually want to see all of these items ranked. This is a great time to use a bump chart. So let's go ahead and build it. Quick table calculation, we'll go to rank and it'll turn into spaghetti. Stick with me. Let's compute using not table across, but per country name. This is really interesting. What this tells us right now is we had a lot less countries in the data set that we had information for before, and we've got a lot more now. So here's a fun one. You can flip your axis. So if you've never done this before, you can right click on the axis. Often we will go ahead and fix this stuff. We can go to reversed and we can go ahead and flip that so that our ranks are at the top and going down as opposed to flipped. Here's another one. We talked about show your filter be working from the data pane. This also works from any other place in the visualization. The reason I love this is when we click show filter here, it's going to add that data pill, but we've already done a bunch of work, right? We've already taken the GDP, we've done our calculation for rank, we told it how to execute that calculation, and yes, we could pull it back onto the filters and do it all again, but wouldn't it be nice if it was just already done? We can change this. Let's just show the top 20. And if you want to use the pill again, you can hold down command and we'll go ahead and add that, let's say, to the label. Labels get a little crazy. Let's talk about them. Let's go ahead and come into the label. And instead of showing all of them, let's just show the most recent. I think these get underutilized quite a bit where we've got the marks that we, or labels we can add to our marks, but we could just show the stuff that matters the most. So anytime we can clean it up, that's a great thing to do. So here we go. Let's say we've got our 1 through 20. Let's go ahead and add the country name as well. We'll go to label and let's go to label and let's clean this up because this is too messy for me. So let's go ahead and add this side by side, make it bold. I'm gonna say okay. And as this starts to clean up, this is looking better. We're also gonna change our alignment here so we can go to the top and kind of keep everything nice and tidy. I'm gonna, again, these cards are movable, right? All of this can change. So I'm gonna move this around. So I've got some more breathing room. You can always edit your axis. So if we go to edit axis, here, I'm going to go ahead and fix this. I know when the data starts and stops. So I'm going to go to 2018 and 19, not 1790, that would be too far away, 1970. Say okay. That'll kind of clean it up. So we've got some nice set there. You could do the same thing here. And I'm going to go ahead and just for the heck of it, make these lines a little thinner. Okay, so we've got our labels working. If you ever have labels that are disappearing, don't forget, you can always check this, allow labels to overlap other marks. So if things are kind of hiding and you really want to have a complete set, you can check that box right there. And then the last thing I like to tell people is, remember, Tableau is adding a lot of extra lines here. So if we go to format this, we can always basically just erase anything we don't need. Difference between borders and lines. Borders go on the outside of your visualization. Lines are actually things on the inside. So here we just have lines. We've got a zero line that we can get rid of. We've got our grid lines happening that we can get rid of. We can get rid of our axis rulers across the board. See if we have anything else hiding. Nope, that looks like it cleans it up. So I like to think of this as just taking an eraser when you're all done. If you were drawing this by hand, you would have to add those reference points for yourself to build an accurate visualization. Then you'd erase them when you're done. So you can go ahead and do that as well. Okay, I think that takes us to tooltips. One of my favorite things, show your work in your tooltips. So what is this ranking of? It's of the GDP constant. So let's go ahead and add that to the tooltip. It helps build the audience's confidence that they know what's happening. Why is the United States number one here? Oh, I can see that it has the highest GDP. Other thing, when you go into your tooltips, you take the time always clean this stuff up. But One thing that I think we don't do enough is uncheck this include command button. So I wish this personally was off by default. When you click on a mark, which we encourage people to do, and especially as they're learning Tableau, they will, we can go ahead and see these buttons come up. Now, if you work in Tableau all the time, keep only, exclude, make a group, make a set, view the data, makes perfect sense. But most of the time, most folks aren't actually using that. So you can just uncheck this include command button. And then when someone clicks on something, they get their tooltip, it highlights, but they're not in a situation where they accidentally break your entire visualization, get down to just the United States, and then they feel like they've broken something when that was our fault. We should have taken that option out to begin with. Last thing, I love to duplicate sheets, even when I'm pretty happy with this visualization. Here's a great example. If we take this and we just show, let's say, the first and the last year, our bump chart will become a slope chart, really emphasizes China's sort of meteoric rise, where other people have fallen. My big recommendation is clean up your tooltips first, because now we got to clean up our tooltips in two places instead of one. All right, that's our visualization. How are we doing on time? 6 minutes. And just to keep you honest, me honest, there you can see that it's actually 6:06. So let's see if we can finish this up. Let's talk about dashboard sizes. So here we have a dashboard. Everything's nice and tidy on our dashboard. When you set the size, I love to use range. Range, I think, doesn't get used enough. Usually we have this at a fixed size or automatic. Range gives you some control the way you would with a fixed size, but also allows the dashboard to contract and expand with the dimensions of the screen it's viewed on, which makes your audience just feel like you built it just for their screen. People feel very nice about that. I would recommend keeping the ratios of the max and min size the same. So one of my favorite settings is just 1000 by 500, 1400 by 700 pixels. Makes it nice and easy for that kind of growing and expanding. The other thing I would say is, as you start to build your final dashboard, go check the sizing in wherever it's gonna live. So two tips here, check it on a laptop and a desktop. If you can pull it back and forth, if you have, you know, a bigger screen you work on and then a laptop maybe you travel with, test it on both. Also test going ahead and publishing it right to Tableau Server before you've even put anything on it, but just to accommodate any of the extra framing that Tableau Server can put around it. Because sometimes something will look perfect on our laptop or on our desktop as we're building. We publish it to Server and we're like, oh, I forgot it has all that extra stuff. All right, let's talk containers. I'm a big fan of containers, but I think they can be pretty fickle when you first get to know containers. So here are some container tips. Like we said, we've got tiled and floating. If you can use tiled, do it. Floating, really here's the best use for floating. We'll skip to this one right away. If you go to a vertical container and you bring it out and it's floating, what it means is, let's try that again, that it can move anywhere. So tiled, it's all in conjunction. If you, you know, move this container over here, this one will shrink and vice versa. They're in conversation with each other. The floating objects are literally sitting on an XY coordinate. As your dashboard grows and contracts, they don't really work with you as well. But one really cool thing, for a floating container, you can add this show hide button, which gives you the ability to hide or show the container and any sheets or anything else you put inside of it. Got a brilliant client who puts all of their filters in here because they use a ton of filters. They need them for their executive dashboards. Put all the filters here and then get rid of them. Save all of your real estate for actually what you're working with. When you bring out, we'll go back to tiled. Let's say we bring out a horizontal container. One thing I recommend, go ahead and put blank objects in both of them right away. Why? Because now you can see what is actually happening here. And it's so much easier, for example, to bring something else out. So if we bring out a text box and we just say, hello world, this is now much easier to add, even if I'm going to get rid of these blank containers. It helps me establish that, hey, this is a horizontal container, and it makes it easier to work with. Another thing I love to do is you can, I found this out this year, double click on your little four bar arrow here, and it takes you a level up. So it takes you from the object to the container that it's in. And also you can always distribute contents evenly, which really gives you a nice nice balance as you're working. So if we come back to, for example, a dashboard that's already been built, if we are looking at this, let's say we click here and we want to see where do these objects live, we can use these tricks, right? We can say, all right, this is a text box. It's living inside a horizontal container, sitting inside a vertical container, which is sitting inside a horizontal container next to this container. You can see how this gets a little meta inception-y sort of things, but they really do work this way if you will take the time to test them out and be patient with them. They're finicky little buggers. Okay, we're down to the last 2 minutes. Here we go. Six more tips. Let's talk about the layout tab. So we use our dashboard tab over here. Layout is sitting right behind here. One thing that if you are using floating items or you're just wondering where things are sitting, you can look at your XY coordinates here, which will literally be the pixels. So if I, for example, have put, go one more level up, 16 pixels of outer padding around this container to give us our little kind of white card-like border. This is sitting at 0, 0. But if I come in and I'm looking now at this container, this is starting at 16, 16. That makes perfect sense for what we're working with. You can also see the width and the height with if you're trying to set something like Lucas was in exactly a specific position for a floating object, this is the perfect place to do it. You can also always change your background color. So the way we make this gray, this container, we make that background color happen right here. Outer padding bumps things away from other objects. So if I add outer padding to this container, take a look between these two grays. If I add it right here on the right side, let's say I give myself 16 pixels, you see that it goes away. If I want these to sit right next to each other, I don't want to have outer padding, but inner padding gives me, especially with text, some nice breathing room around the edges, which really makes it feel nice and tight and clean. So if you're someone, I work in Adobe quite a bit. If you're someone who's used to more of the design products side of things, inner and outer padding was something that we cheered for very loudly at the Tableau conference when it was put out. Here's something that Lucas actually taught me the other day. You can name your objects in your item hierarchy. So last two tips, item hierarchy is here. If you have something, let's say this is all of our tips, right? Our text along the bottom. You can just right click and rename the dashboard item or put it right here. You could say, these are our instructions. And okay, timer's going off, but here's the final tip. Stop timer. The final tip. When you are working with dashboard layouts, often Tableau will generate a lot of extra containers as you go. So the very final thing I like to do before I publish something, come into the item hierarchy and click through all your containers and make sure they make sense. So we have a tiled object and we have a horizontal container with two verticals. You can see how this is changing. Then inside this vertical, I've got a vertical up here. I've got my title, and I literally will go through all of these just to click through, make sure everything makes sense, name what you need, and make sure Tableau hasn't added a bunch of extra containers there as well. Okay, whew, so a couple seconds over, but I'm gonna take it. Go ahead and bring you back here. That was quite a lot for a very short amount of time. So if you are interested in getting all of those tips written down somewhere for you where you didn't have to write them down yourself, you can just head to datadozen.com, Tableau speed tipping, got this here. We'll put the video here, got the dashboard here if you wanna deconstruct it. One of the best ways to learn is just to grab other people's dashboards off Tableau Public and start building them. And then we've got this pocket guide right here. You guys are welcome to download this and just take a look and see. Hopefully this will give you something for 2021. So adding some tools, hopefully, to your toolkit. With that, I just want to say thank you guys so much for all of your participation. It's been really fun to still figure out how to do KC Tug in a virtual format and all of this. It's definitely been something that I know we have all looked forward to, and it's just great to see you guys all here as well. So with that, Sean, I'm going to hand it back to you.
All right. Awesome, Erin. That was amazing. Definitely had some great stuff. So right as you started, I suggested that people type a +1 in the chat anytime that you mentioned or showed anything that they learned. So you can scroll through the chat to see how many people enjoyed all of your stuff. I didn't annotate them So I don't know where in your present, you can kind of do the math of kind of figuring out where the plus ones happen, but a lot of really great plus ones. So everybody really enjoyed that. So that was awesome. Yeah, thank you for all that. So really good stuff. All right. So we're going to wrap things up here. And I'm really excited about this because this is something that I don't get to do very often, which is give presentations in PowerPoint and not Tableau. I mainly just talk about Tableau. So what I'm going to talk to you guys about today, let me share my screen here and we'll get started. So this is going to be all about sharing, setting your intentions for 2021 with the Tableau community. I've been involved with the Tableau community for years, going on 6 years now. Back in 2015 is when I started. And there are so many different ways to get involved. And you can get involved with any of these that I'm going to share with you. And you get to choose your participation level, at what level you want to be able to participate. So you'll notice here, I'm not using the word resolution. I'm not using the word goals. I'm using the word intentions. That is deliberate. We'll get into that a little bit. But before you do that, let's see, there we go. So what I really want you all to focus on is take a step back. Think back to 2020. What did you like? What happened that was really good? I assure you, in this crazy world that we've had, in this crazy year that we've had, there are some good things that have really happened. And then start looking to 2021. How do you grow from here? Where do you go from here? What do you want to get better at? What do you want to improve? And these can be as broad or as specific as you want. Find your community. And that's what my job here is, to show you all of the different ways that you can get involved. However level of involvement you want to get involved at. And I've got some tips and tricks at the end of where and how to do that. So like I said, even in this incredibly generationally atypical year, there were positives that happened, regardless of everyone's different scenarios and circumstances. There has been good things, and I know that we all had to kind of shift the way that we do things, right? And so just think back on those things, and reflect on them. Talk about the good, think about the not so good, and just reflect on them. And then take those reflections and create some intentions. So what is an intention? Why am I using that word? I've been there. Everybody, when you hear the word New Year's resolution, there's probably a part of you that goes, ugh, because we're probably, I think it's safe to say, we're probably not that great at keeping our resolutions. So I'm trying a different word, setting intentions. And then when I actually started looking at the definitions of different words, I actually really started to like this word. So it is defined as an act or an instance of determining mentally upon some action or result. It's an aim that guides action. What do I mean by that? I mean, the journey, right, is where everything is, where all the learning takes place. It's not the end goal, right? It's, you know, that's why generally if you set resolutions or anything like that, you'll say, I'm going to work out 5 days a week, or I'm going to complete every single Makeover Monday challenge this year. So I'm going to do all 52 weeks of Makeover Monday, or something along those lines, right? Maybe you've made those. I know I have, and I've failed every single time. And I realized as I was reflecting that the reason I was doing that is because I was setting myself up. I was setting myself up because at any time, as we know, especially after this year, things can change. in a heartbeat. So by setting an intention, what would that sound like? I want to be more involved in Makeover Monday. You're not giving yourself, but you're providing yourself a plan to be more involved. So even if that's 1, 2, 3, or 52, you're still setting that intention. Additionally, with setting intentions, you can get very specific. Maybe you just watched Lucas's presentation and you're like, there are so many new features of Tableau that I don't get to use in my day-to-day job. I would really like to start to learn some of those. So I would like to learn some of those tips and tricks. That's an intention. I want to learn more about the Tableau, the product, right? Then once you set the intention, then you need to start getting other things. You need to start putting some stuff behind that into your plan to do that. So that's what the next section is going to be about. Finding your community, surrounding yourself with like-minded people, shared interests, who are all at the same stage as you. And I assure you, there are people who are at your stage, regardless of where you are on the experience spectrum, they are everywhere. So I've got about 12 to 14 different communities that you can get involved in right now, and you can just go through there. You can pick one or more. My job here is to just show you what's out there, and then you can take your interests, find one, play with one, see if you like it. If you don't like it, that's okay. There are lots of others. So the first one that we'll get to is the one that we all know, Makeover Monday. Makeover Monday is easily the most popular community, but its simple premise is it's a weekly challenge. So every single week comes out on, the challenge starts on Sunday, and you can go to the website, makeovermonday.co.uk, and you can see this is a project that has been going on since 2016. And they keep a running history of all of the different challenges that they've done. But it is basically, you find a chart, they find a chart or a visualization on the internet that is ineffective. They grab the underlying data and a picture of that, and then they share that out with the community. And your goal there is to improve the original chart or tell a different story, right? We all know that there are several stories within a data set. The same thing is true with this. And this is really great. I love Makeover Monday. It's part of the reason for my success. I can't say enough about it. It's not just because I did the challenges. It's because I engaged with the community. I put myself out there. I know that that can be very intimidating for a lot of people. I totally respect that. But you have nothing to lose by putting yourself out in the community. I will tell you, there is no other user community like the one that Tableau has built and fostered. I have received nothing but honest, open feedback. People are willing to help and willing to share ideas and willing to help you get over that hump, which is really great. And then the way that the feedback fosters itself and pays itself forward for the next generation, it just continues on. So Makeover Monday is great. I highly recommend it. It's great for really starting to learn what Tableau can do for you. Practicing your analysis skills, practicing your design skills, practicing different chart types. That's one of the great things about Makeover Monday is it's different data. And all of these, I would say, all of these communities that I'm about to show you, it's all getting you out of the comfortableness of the type of data that you work with. You work with one type of data every single day. It gets boring, right? Maybe you really like maps, but your data that you work with on a day-to-day basis doesn't have any geographical elements. Wouldn't it be great if you could go find some data to go play with maps and make really awesome, beautiful maps in Tableau? This is where you can do that. And it's just, it's really great. So definitely give Makeover Monday a chance. The other one is Workout Wednesday. And similar to Makeover Monday, it is weekly, but the premise is completely different. You've probably seen these, likely you've seen these, but basically you're given the data, a workbook or a picture of the final product, and a set of requirements to get you from canvas to final product. And your challenge is to reproduce to as close as possible that original challenge and see how well you do. Now, I know that sometimes when you look at a challenge, you're like, I have no idea where to start. That is a very real concern, but I would challenge you to just jump in. If you see it, you say, okay, I can see that's a bar chart. I know how to make a bar chart, or I know how to make a line chart. And then it's just doing a lot of those little things like Lucas did to just kind of see, okay, I know that I need to do an action. I know I can see he's got parameters in there. So what do I need to learn about parameters that can help me get to where I need to go? I am one of the contributing members of Workout Wednesday. So next year in 2021, one challenge every single month will be something that that I put together. So I'm definitely going to plug this one. And we span across the, there's no way for us to say sometimes it could be really, really easy challenges. Sometimes it's going to be a little bit more challenging. I will say, however, in the 4 years that we've done Workout Wednesday, there's only one challenge that has anything to do with trigonometry. So we do not use, I don't think we've ever said it. It's kind of an unwritten rule, but there is no radials. There's no Sankeys. There's no anything like that. These are business dashboards, business use cases, very similar to what Lucas did earlier. And your challenge is to learn those tips and tricks, learn those latest release features of Tableau to take your experience of the product to the next level. So definitely check that out. Workout-Wednesday.com. Again, what are the benefits of doing the weekly challenges, Workout Wednesday and Makeover Monday? Repetition. We all know the greatest way to grow in a skill is to practice a lot. And the weekly challenges give you that. They allow you to jump in or out at any given point. We know that things change. We know that things come up. But by having something weekly, you can just pick up the next week or the next, or in a month, or, hey, you know what? I need to take a step back. Got some things going on at work. I've certainly had those moments very frequently where I've had to take a step back in some of this stuff, but it's always there. And it's always welcoming for people to come back to whenever they want. Like I mentioned earlier, it's always something new. You know, especially with Makeover Monday, you get to learn new chart. You get to learn with new data, different chart types, different features, and you can kind of make it whatever you want. And then focus. One of the things that I really like about both the two challenges that I mentioned is it allows you to time box yourself. And you can say, okay, I have found an hour this week where I can sit down and focus on doing a Makeover Monday dashboard getting as far as I can with a Workout Wednesday challenge. I'm going to give myself an hour and I'm going to see what I can create. And then after that hour, you walk away, you're done. That's it. You're done for the week. If you just set that intention and continue moving, it can really take you a long way. So definitely check those out. All right. So now we're going to get into some of the more nuanced, some of the more specialty challenges. This is where you can really kind of find your interests and really kind of take that to where you want to. So another one, Sports Viz Sunday. is what it is. It's sports data. It's really unique sports data, though. And it's not just going to, you know, some, it's not just, you know, going and getting baseball box scores and seeing who has the most first base hits, or looking at who's thrown the most yards in the NFL. It's, I mean, they do things like last month they had a challenge on boxing data, which was a really cool challenge. I mean, who would have thought there'd be so much data about boxing, enough to build a dashboard about and start a conversation with, and not just number of wins, but there's some really detailed data sets on boxing, you know, number of punches thrown versus number of blocks, all those types of things. So really, really cool stuff. They also have theme challenges. So sometimes the data is given. They always give a few data sets, but this month, December, they're doing female sports. So create something centered around female sports, right? They give a few data sets out there, but you can kind of take it wherever you want to go, which is really cool. They are monthly, so every new month is a new challenge. And like I said, so if you're a sports nut and you like data visualization, this is the one for you. The next one, which is kind of near and dear to my heart, just based on what I do in my day-to-day job, is Project HealthViz, and it is healthcare data, and not just the healthcare data that you're thinking about. This is global, right? So it's not, they try and do it, you know, they try and take it outside of just the United States umbrella of health, because, you know, we know that healthcare is a global situation, and there's healthcare data everywhere. So very, very cool stuff. It is person-centric data, which offers a lot of really interesting ways to build new things into practice new techniques in your data visualizations. You know, telling a story. With telling a story with data is a lot easier when a person is at the center of it. Because generally, I think just in our minds, when we hear story, we think it's more personal. And with person-centric data, it's a lot easier to do that. They also have a participation tracker. So you can see which months you have completed. That's built into the platform. Really, really cool stuff. Definitely check that out if you're into healthcare data and person-centric data like that. All right, this one's kind of new, and I'm really, really excited to see where this goes. I think it's got you know, some really cool ways to go. So it's called Real World Fake Data. It is relatively new. It just kicked off a couple months ago, or last month, I should say. But this is business ready dashboards, right? This is business data that has been either fake data or synthesized data, but this is like as true to the data that we work with in our everyday jobs. And maybe you don't want to build some highly designed, overly complicated dashboard, but what you're really good at, or what you really want to work on, is you want to build a business ready dashboard and practice those things. This is that challenge. This is that initiative for you. The data is provided. So somebody is actually working behind the scenes to create fake data sets. They've already had a couple of challenges. They started with HR data. So they created a data set that was, you know, very HR centric. They've also done a financial data, which is, and I'm not just talking about Superstore. They actually kind of went outside the four walls of Superstore and created a completely different, looking at like profit and loss and how you can kind of start to look at accounting in different ways, which is really, really cool. So I'm really excited to see where this goes. It's relatively new, and it's definitely an area of the community that I think has a lot of potential, because I think this is where a lot of people want to practice, right? They don't necessarily want to go create some overly designed dashboard for Makeover Monday. They just want to create a business dashboard, and you can do that. So definitely look for this one. It's going to be, it's got some legs to it. So really excited about this one. The next one is a completely interesting one. Storytelling with Data, which is from Cole Nafflick. She's a data visualization author and instructor. She's actually created her own community on her website. But these are really focusing on the elements of storytelling with data. Highly recommend you find the book. It's on, you can get it on your Kindle. You can buy the paperback version, but really, really great stuff. And it again, this is very business centric. So thinking about how you can make your charts and your dashboards better in a business sense, and really telling the story of your data. Which is really good. It is tool agnostic. So if you're not in Tableau, or maybe you're looking to pick up a new tool like Power BI or Click or something like that, you can use those tools in for this challenge. And then the other good thing is that they have both challenges, which are longer monthly things, but they also have like a bank of exercises where you're given a visual, and you're just like, okay, just focus on this one. Maybe an exercise is focusing on a good chart title, and how can you incorporate a really good chart title into something that you're building? And then that would be an exercise. And then a challenge is more like creating a dashboard or a visual that's just focused on a chart type. So I know they've had a couple of like dot plots, right? So what you build, whatever you want, go find whatever data you want, but create a visual, tell a story with data, and use a dot plot, which is really cool. So, and again, it already has a built-in community, which you can join for free or not. So it's again, the level of involvement is totally up to you. All right, moving on. A few more as we kind of start to land here, but really, really cool stuff. So this is the Sustainable Development Goals VIS project, or the SDG VIS project, which is really cool. Basically the UN came up with 17 different goals for global sustainable development to be achieved across all of the UN countries through 2030. So basically what this project does, focuses on one of those elements, one of those 17 elements, gives you the data to help support that, like could be literacy, it could be, energy consumption, those types of tenants. It is a global mission. You get to do good with data, and you get to raise awareness. So if you're kind of skewed and interested in those types of initiatives, this is a really good idea here. Next one is Viz to Educate. These are both relatively new. Viz to Educate is something that I just found out about like last night. So I put an APB out to the rest of my network and said, hey, I've got this list of projects that anybody can just jump in at any time. What am I missing? And these two popped up. And Viz to Educate is really interesting. So basically create a bank of dashboards and visualizations that are tied to some global curriculum. Right now, the challenge is geography. So go create a dashboard about volcanoes. And then what's gonna happen is your visualization will be hosted on a website where the goal is to share those visualizations in educational resources so that teachers can start to incorporate data visualization in their curriculum to teach students, which is really, really cool. And anybody can do this, right? So again, please don't feel that, well, my talents aren't up to that, up to the level where I want that. Get in and get involved. At least take the data and practice. Maybe work towards that goal. Maybe your intention that you set for 2021 is I want to submit an entry to one of these. And then you can start working through those different data sets to get up to the level of until you're comfortable doing that. So really cool stuff. I'm really excited about this one to see where it goes. All right, next one is themed. This is Iron Quest. So Iron Quest is really great. It stemmed from Iron Viz competition. So we know Iron Viz, global competition for Tableau, talking about how to kind of use Tableau, do some really cool stuff with. Iron Quest is kind of a subset of that. It's run by people in the community. It's meant to grow your skills in such a way that you would feel comfortable entering Iron Viz. So it's an Iron Quest. So the quest is to enter Iron Viz. Bring your own data, three themed challenges, and you can also receive feedback as well. And then lastly, the last one that we're going to touch on this for data visualization is Viz for Social Good, which is a chance to help nonprofits analyze and socialize their work. And there's lots of regional chapters globally and here in the US. So definitely check those out as well. And then don't forget about the data. There's actually two challenges here that are all about just wrangling data, talking about data. So prepping data, Tableau prep, weekly challenges. They also provide solution blogs and videos. So if you're using Tableau prep in your work, you can use this to learn the product to see how it goes. If you want to learn a completely new tool, definitely check out Tidy Tuesday. Tidy is a library for learning R, which is a statistical programming language, weekly challenges, and it's all about data wrangling, data prep, and visualization in R, which is really cool. So they've got a GitHub site that has all the challenges back to 2018, which is really cool. So those are the communities. Hopefully there's one that sparked your interest. And now I want to tell you about how to get involved. So there, again, the level of involvement is up to you. My job is just to show you, just to give you some options to do that. First one is Twitter, obviously. I will say that is where the majority of the broad community lives, to share, grow, and learn. I do fully understand some people's relationship with social media and Twitter. And so totally understand that, but that is the best way to get involved because that's where we all hang out. So if you wanna get feedback from people like me and people who are way better than me, definitely this is the place to go. But again, totally up to you. There are other options out there. Another one is LinkedIn. We probably all have a LinkedIn profile and we're probably not utilizing it to the best that we can. This is a great place to show your work, grow your network at the same time, right? And just get connected with people who are doing the same kinds of things. It might even, get you leads on prospects, right? So, but it's another way to get in there. Again, it is social media, totally understand that. So that's why I tried to think of other ways to get involved. I bet most of you have a way you have throughout your week, you have a Zoom call or in a meeting room if you're face-to-face, where you just feel like the meeting is dead time, right? Use that time to your advantage. Create a quick team and say, hey, let's do Workout Wednesday together. Let's spend an hour and let's all get together and let's just do a Makeover Monday challenge. Keep it within the safe space of the people at work. Maybe you find some coworkers who are really into sports data. Maybe you've got an NCAA bracket challenge. You can bring that data in and you can grab some coworkers and just go do that. So this is a really fun way to start getting involved in the community. You're still learning. You're still putting yourself out there. But it's a little bit more contained. It's a little bit more of a safe space. Totally cool. Highly recommend you do that. And then the last one, definitely want to check out is the KC Slack. We're here. All of the leaders of the steering committee are on Slack, and we would love to have everyone sharing their work. We will provide feedback to whatever level you're comfortable with. And I'm sure that, and you can get feedback from other people, not just the people on the steering committee, but anybody in the Slack channel. So there are other ways to get involved. Don't feel like you have to get a Twitter profile. You have to get on LinkedIn. There are other ways. Be creative. But I would say definitely, if I were to leave you with one thing, don't try and go it alone. Get with a community. Could be one other person, could be 10 other people, could be 10,000. Do it together. Learn together. You'll have a much better time. You'll be able to bounce ideas off of each other. Everybody grows that much faster when you work with other people. So coming in for a landing here, hopefully you've learned about a few new community projects out there for you to get involved with, practice your skills, grow your skills, grow your network. Hopefully by this time next year, you'll be that much better in whatever you set your intentions. So thank you. And with that, go forth and viz. All right. Questions? Yeah. You might be on mute still, Jay. All right, questions. Where can I find the Tableau, the Kansas City Tech Slack? I will send out an email tomorrow, wrap-up email to everyone who registered, and I will have a link to our KC Tug Slack channel in there. So I'm not going to share that out now because this is going on YouTube, and I want to keep this kind of local to Kansas City. So look for that tomorrow, Mike. Excellent. All right. Parting words. Jay, any parting words for 2020?
I would say just reiterating your community is like the biggest thing, and that's what helps you learn. And I mean, generally everybody in the Tableau community is pretty excited about Tableau and loves helping people. And so I mean, that's why I have a job, right? So it's I love doing it, love helping people. And so yeah, just reach out on Slack or try to build that within your company too. That's the biggest driver for growth in Tableau. And the more people that know it, the better you get too. So yep. Just try to grow it.
Cool. Erin, what do you got?
Yeah, I would really underscore the work with your coworkers. I would say the best community that I ever was a part of was long ago in a previous life. I worked at WashU in St. Louis, and we made a Tableau user group very early on. We thought we were very clever. We did like a raffle where everyone put in their ideas for what to call it, and someone came up with the idea Tableau user group TUG. How cute was that? So WUTUG, Washington University TUG, was we thought we'd come up with it. We were so proud. But I would say that was, you know, I love having the local Kansas City. I love having the broader communities. And it's really fun when you're able to kind of layer those together. So I would just underscore, if you can find a buddy or even a local, you know, if your organization doesn't have an internal TUG, put on your brave hat and, you know, try creating a meeting, you know, once a quarter just to start out. But these are the folks that will know your data better than anyone else. And these are the folks that'll probably have solved a lot of the same problems or be struggling with a lot of the same problems that you are. So that community can be really fantastic. And I would also just say, we're looking forward to 2021. So if you want to present, if you're sick of seeing our four names and faces up here, let us know. You know, I think Lucas's example today was such a fabulous example of taking, here's the problem we were presented and here was the solution we came up with. If you have something like that that you would like to share in 2021, reach out to any of us on Slack. We're going to be starting to build out those agendas and we'd really love to have more folks from the community presenting. So let us know.
Yep, absolutely. Excellent. Lucas, anything?
I wanted to double down on your comment regarding to LinkedIn. That's not a place that people normally think about going into for tips, but a lot of what I learned recently has been from there. It's just amazing, the tidbits that you'll find on it. So, you know, definitely check that out, regardless of if you're looking for a job or not. I mean, it's a great resource to learn Tableau. And just tip is just be curious. Don't settle for, like I said, this can be done or it can't be done. Sure, it's great to, Tableau isn't out of the box. I mean, click and drag and drop and that good stuff and an easy tool to use, but it's when you know the ins and outs and you know how to do the workarounds on it that your skills are going, your learning curve is just going to skyrocket. So just be curious and adventure into the tool.
Excellent. Good parting words. All right, Kansas City. That wraps up 2020 from us. Thank you so much for joining us this year in this virtual format. We're going to continue this cadence. Hopefully, it is my greatest hope that hopefully this time next year we will be at a bar somewhere with enjoying some delicious beverages, shaking hands at whatever safe distance we are, but we will be out of our houses and we'll be involved again. So thank you so much. Happy holidays, be safe, happy new year, and we'll talk to you next year.